Let's talk about something slightly less intense, but no less important, because it happens to all of us as well. You want to get somebody's compliance? Of course you do. At times you want people's compliance. You want them to do what you want them to do. And at times they want you to do what they want you to do. They try to get your compliance. These right here are principles used in sales. In fact, I told you the other day, I've been in three sales, high pressure sales situations, and I resisted all of them. And at the end of the session, I recommend that they all buy the book, Influence, Science and Practice by Robert Cialdini. Because I know what you're doing. I know how you're doing it. I know why you're doing it, even if you don't know why you're doing it. I know why it works most of the time. And that's where you get something practical out of these lectures. Now you know. Foot in the door, door in the face, flip sides. Agreeing to a lesser commitment, we're more likely than to agree to a larger commitment. It's related to lowballing. Giving a great deal, so what's a lowball? You got a salesperson, they say, here's this brand new awesome car. You're interested in the brand new awesome car. Let's say the car costs $25,000 list price. And they say, today I could get it to you for $18,000. And you're like, wow, that is a deep discount. They don't just say that, then they get you in the car. And they drive you around in the car. And they say, man, you're going to look sharp going around in your new car. They start talking about it like it is your car. And you get back to the sales dealership office and start producing papers. And then you sign that you're willing to buy this car. You've now made a commitment to $18,000 on this car. They've got you in. Then the salesperson says, I'll be right back. Goes out. Probably sits at the water cooler for a few minutes and comes back in with a forlorn face. Oh, I'm so sorry. It's my mistake. The manager says, I'm not authorized to offer that. I screwed up. I'm not allowed to sell this car for $18,000. Best I can do is $21,500. Now you go, that's a lot more than what I just agreed to, but you just agreed to it. Ratcheting it up. They go, well, it's still substantially less than 25. You're still getting a really good deal. Oh, guess you're right. It is a nice car. And you've got people more likely than to buy it at 21.5. And then when you've committed that number, they might say, well, would you like an underbody coat? Would you like air conditioning? Would you like a radio? Would you like keys? A few little fees, a little thing here and there. And pretty soon you're about up where they would have offered it to you anyway. But now you've actually committed to buying it. Door in the face, start with a large, unreasonable request, which is gonna be turned down, but if you're the requester, you know it's gonna be turned down. And then a smaller commitment looks much more reasonable by comparison. And if you got consistency thing going, we all like to see ourselves as generous, for example, right? So if I say, could you donate $100 to my cause? Most people will say, Lord, no, I don't have $100 to spare. I mean, it's a really worthy cause. Of course, I support it in spirit, but I can't give you $100 for it. And they go, well, okay. Well, what about five? Compared to 100, five seems really reasonable. And you're more likely to get the five than if you had come right out and asked for five to begin with. In fact, there's a thing called legitimization of paltry sums, where if you tell people, you go up asking for money, and you say, even a penny would help. It's harder in the day of plastic because people don't carry so much cash. But if you would say, even a penny would help, who sees themselves as so stingy that they wouldn't give a penny to a good cause? And guess what? They give more often, and they give more than a penny, and they give more on average than a control group of people just asked to give whatever they can. Legitimizing a paltry sum gets you more compliance. It gets more of what you're after. So if you're a salesperson, and you might be, remember I told you, you people in health behavior change, right? Doctors, physical therapists, nurses, mental health, you want people to change. You want them to comply. So compliance can be benevolent. It doesn't always have to be used in a selfish way. Social facilitation or inhibition is related to a thing that I've talked about in another seminar on study skills or anxiety, which is the Yerkes-Dodson performance arousal graph, inverted U. You have the worst performance at low arousal and really high arousal. The best performance is with medium arousal. Social facilitation and inhibition means that our performance on any given task is affected by the presence or non-presence of other people. Social influence at its purest. Other people just being there affects your abilities in a way that is measurable. When a task is simple and well learned, and you would have low arousal on it anyway, knowing that your best performance is meeting arousal, having other people around actually raises your level of arousal. If other people are watching you, there's a social pressure to perform. It increases your arousal and you're able to perform better than you might have otherwise. But if a task is complex or unfamiliar, a person's performance is hindered because of the presence of others. So if it's hard to do it and other people around, you still get that boost in arousal, but now it's too high because you were already challenged to do the task. Having other people around watching you do the task puts you past the prime middle level that you would try to achieve. Tim Smith was a basketball player here at ETSU, and I went to a basketball game here at which he was almost guaranteed to break a school record in points scored. And it was interesting, and I can't attribute it directly to this because it wasn't an experiment, but it seemed to apply to me. The whole crowd knew he was going to make this record happen tonight. And he was a stellar performer, obviously, or he wouldn't be in that territory to begin with. But the first half of the game, he performed poorly. He did not sink the baskets. He did not make the simple shots. He was doing really badly, and people were getting agitated. I mean, what was happening? He knew everybody expected him to sink baskets. Now, just by enough times to the hoop, he broke the record, and after that, he was fine. He performed just like he always performed after that. The pressure to break the record was off. Where did the pressure come from? It came from outside, everybody cheering, or again, and inside. It's a social inhibition that was happening. And as soon as he went past that mark, he was probably facilitated by everybody cheering and being very jubilant that he had done this amazing task. Social loafing. Y'all know this in group work. When people are in groups, they give less effort than they would if they were alone. Right? Not everybody. There's usually that type A plus person all wound up, anal retentive, who's going to do all the work for the whole group to make sure they get that A. And most people are happy to let them do it. Right? Because most people don't give their full effort. They did an interesting physical task that demonstrated this well, which was tug of war. Right? Pulling on a rope. Measuring the pressure, pounds per square inch, that each individual could muster on their own. Pulling the rope. So you have an objective number. What is the person capable of doing on their own? Well, you get now a group of those people together, and you should know exactly what they can do as a group. But what they found is they did far less than that. They didn't do what they theoretically could do as a group, because when in a group, we do less. There's less responsibility placed directly on us, less social pressure to perform, and we compensate by allowing other people to do the things that we came to do. It's a diffusion of responsibility. Diffusion of responsibility is a tendency to feel less personally responsible for a task when it's spread across members of a group. Now, that has practical significance when you are actually working with members of a group in a work environment or in a school environment, because now you know that they're not just being lazy, they're being human. This is what we human beings do. When in these situations with other people, we do less. If you're pointed out as responsible and you're personally accountable for the outcome, you'll do more because now the pressure is directed at you. But when it's the group, it's not me, it's we. We did this or we didn't do that, not me.